Now, since last September 2018, I have been putting up on Pfanderfilms these FAQs, frequently asked questions that Muslims have been throwing at us, particularly down at Speaker's Corner over the last 25 years. And I've been putting them into small sound bites, anywhere from 5 to 10 minutes, sometimes a little bit over 10, sometimes just under 5. And the reason why is because so many people have asked me to help them out with these kind of questions. I did a series in California last September, and I went and did something like 23 in one day. And the people there at the studio says, you've got to do this for everybody else because this is so important. This is what people really need. They need to know how to answer these questions using what I call the three C's, quick, concise, yet comprehensive. Now, I know I can't spell, Q is not a C, but it sounds like a C to me, so I'll leave it there. Quick, that means to be right, get to the nub of the problem. Concise, that means don't get verbose, don't get into an awful lot of plethora of verbosity. Yet comprehensive, yet get the entire material that needs, the content needs to be there. So that's what I've been doing since last September, and I'm writing them up, and they'll be put into a written form as well. Did 40 of them, and I'll be doing more. 41, 42, 43 are in the can. They will be coming up later. But what I'm going to do now is I'm going to start a whole new series, and this time, rather than going and looking at how to answer the questions that Muslims are throwing at us, we're now going to go on the offense and start throwing questions at them. And to begin with, I want to start with this book here, the Qur'an. Now, you might say, hold on, Jay, you've already done a number of videos on the Quran, and all the ones that I have done on the Quran have been the what we call the external critique, which is looking at the Quran externally, looking and see it historically, see now how what the manuscript evidence is, the debate that was supposed to have happened, and then the lecture that I was supposed to do there at City University in Hong Kong got banned, and that video just went up about a weekend or two ago. It's up there now, and over 11,000 people have already watched that. We're getting lots of feedback on that lecture. That is the historical debate. That is what we call the external debate. Now what I want to do is look at it internally. I want to look at it and unpack its pages. The external debate will continue, and we will come back to it, and I will really unpack, especially when Dr. Dan Brubaker gets his book out on this one here, on the 20 examples of the 20 examples of corrections in the early Quran. Once that gets published, we will then unpack each one of those 20. Al-Fadi and I already did that, and those will be coming up soon. But once Quranic Gateway comes out, that will be even more devastating, because that'll have a lot more to look at. When they are published, when they are in public forum, then I can start talking about it, and I will. What I want to do, though, up till then, until then, is to start really looking at what we know about this book, what we know when we read it, and some of the areas I want to really address concern the whole view of how Muslims regard revelation. What is their view of revelation? What's wrong with their view of revelation? How does it differ from our view of revelation? And why we have a much greater, a better view of revelation than Islam does. I want to look at their view of inspiration, wahi, and show you there are some real problems with wahi, especially when you see what the traditions say concerning how this inspiration came to Muhammad. I want to also look at its universal qualities. And the areas I want to go to for its universal qualities are really two areas. I really want to unpack what the Quran says about women, and whether or not the verses in here about women, especially in chapter 4 and also in chapter 2. When we look and see what the Quran says about women in those two surahs and others as well, whether or not they are applicable for everyone, everywhere, in all places, and at all times. Is that a universal application from what we see in the Quran? Then I also want to go over to the problem of violence and peace. Now, there's an awful lot that we're going to unpack with violence and peace. And the reason why those two areas is because those are the two areas that I know you want to hear the most, and they're the ones that are the most popular. Whenever anybody asks about Islam, when you ask, what is your view of Islam, they come up to the fore. Those are the two things that most people have a problem with. And that's why I want to unpack it. I want to go into it. I want to engage with it, and I want you to see and be able to use it. Well, they're going to go into what we know as abrogation of the Quran. Now, what we mean by that is are the contradictions, the even the law of abrogation. Chapter 2, verse 106, chapter 16, verse 101 is very troubling to me. Why do you even have a law of abrogation built into the Quran? And are the abrogations there? Can we look at them? Let's do look at them. And let's see whether or not this is merely progressive revelation or is this really contradictions. We found over 200. I'll probably be sharing maybe 15 to 20 of them in these videos. Then I want to go into the errors in the Quran, and these are multifaceted. There's quite a few errors in the Quran. Some of them are historical errors, some of them are historical anachronisms, but probably the ones that I would really like to delve into are the scientific errors. Remember the debate that I had a number of weeks ago with Nadia Ahmed? That was really revealing to me. I had never done a debate on that subject, and no one else had either, and that's probably our own fault. I couldn't believe it afterwards just how easy a debate that was, as Eddie Yusuf and I were able to just run circles around Nadir Ahmed, and all he did was repeat, repeat, repeat the same old problem that he found with our Bible. He could not even defend these what he thought were scientific proofs. Every one of them turned into scientific errors. So we're going to look at those scientific errors. We're going to look at each one of them and show that these are not proofs. Every one of them stands against what we now know as science today. And then we want to go into some of the source problems, looking at the stories and where they come through. Now, I have tackled a few of them. I've looked at three of them already. I want to look at others. And I want to ask where these stories come from. Where are all these biblical stories coming from? Where are these stories of Dhul-Qarnayn, Alexander the Great? Where does that come from? Where are they getting them from? What's the sources for all these stories? And does that not say a little bit concerning how this book was derived? So there's an awful lot to do. There's an awful lot to hit. There's going to be an awful lot of material out there. Now, what I would like you to do is to comment in the comment section below. At the bottom of these videos, there's a comment section. We keep them open so that you can engage with these ideas. Don't just look at the videos and then walk away and say, well, that was fun. No, actually engage with it. Both Muslims and Christians, I've been really heartened by how many Muslims are engaging. I'm so glad to see Muslims are watching these videos. I'm glad to see that you're reacting. I'm glad to see that you're not just walking away. The fact that I don't mock, I'm very careful not to mock. The fact that I am trying to be as honest as I can and to try to really unpack everything that I see. And I'll be doing it especially with this series because I want to look and see what the Quran says. I want to look at the verses. I want to exegete them properly. So hold me accountable that I'm doing just that. You hold me accountable. And the rest of you, start discussing. Start debating. Get into it. There's an awful lot of new material that we're going to be hitting. I've not done an awful lot of these before. This is probably the first time that much of what I'm going to be engaging with you've ever heard. So this should be great time. This should be a good series. I'm looking forward to it. Great. We'll see more of you as we start putting these videos up and we start uploading them. Listen, if any of you do want to support our ministry, right up here, go up and look on the homepage. You can see the Patreon button up there. Also, PayPal. Some of you don't like to use Patreon. Use PayPal. We do need your support. It's important that you do support us. We cannot continue out unless we do get support. I do not get a salary. I know some of you Muslims think that I get lots of money. No, I don't get any salary. I am only, all the work that I do, it comes from support. And it comes from support by Christians. I don't want Muslims to support me. You're not supposed to support me. But Christians, please do support. We need it. Fadi needs it. Anybody that's working in this kind of area does need support. God bless you. It's great to know that we have engaged with you, that we're helping you out, and we're giving you material that you can use. But we need to make sure that both sides are heard. We need to make sure that both Muslims and Christians are engaging in this kind of material. So, the Quran, that's next. And we'll be doing an awful lot more videos on just this book. Okay, this is Jay.